but we were just like, and did we just let him do his thing?
That separate ticket?
Well, we didn't go on the field, we just set the ticket for him on the field.
I didn't.
To come join us, but until we're ready, you know?
He's a number one. Bring
the mic.
But if you think about it, just changing the atmosphere over change the worship experience, it won't be like this. You know, we're used to saying and used to doing.
Just having bluegrass music instead of the regular music would change the spirit.
I always like when I do that.
I like doing different stuff, but I don't mind doing it indoors.
You're like my husband. Yeah, so. I didn't have that problem either. So I just said, no. I went on the.
Hey, good morning, good morning. Welcome to the annual church picnic. God bless you all. Good morning, and I am glad you have made your way. If you can find your way to your seats, and if more people come in and you're like, ooh, there's an empty seat next to me, help them find it, because it's always a little intimidating to come in and find a spot. So, welcome. I've got a couple of announcements before we get into worship together. I want to first and foremost say thank you. Can you wave your hands or stand up if you have been here for a couple hours this morning, setting up chairs, setting up tents, bringing worship out? Can you go ahead and let us thank you? Thank you so much. And say thank you to our amazing musicians who are here to lead us in worship. Can we thank God for them and for their willingness to be here? Thank you so much. God bless you all. So as we worship today, here's the two things that you might need as we're worshiping together. If you need a drink because you start getting overheated, there are bottles of water in this red cooler right up here. And so you can grab a bottle of water for yourself if you need one. If you're feeling woozy, if you start feeling too hot, go ahead and take care of that. If then the next thing happens that happens when we drink water and you need a restroom facility, you can find that by going in this door over here and going straight back. You'll see the women's one bathroom right in front of you. Sorry, they are both single person and gender neutral. One right in front of you and one a little bit more to the right. And you are welcome. Just lock the door behind you and that's where you'll find that. So those couple of things while we worship together. It is possible that a siren, a fire truck, or an ambulance, or something else fun will go by while we're worshiping. If I'm talking, I will probably pause because I'm not louder than a fire truck. But I would invite you, whether we're singing, whatever we're doing in worship this morning, if you see an emergency service vehicle or hear one go past, that means inherently that someone is in need of help and that there are people who are racing to answer and they are very much in need of our prayers. And so please take a moment and say a prayer for Godspeed and for quick healing for whoever is in need of it. Okay, what else do I want to tell you? I want to tell you that coming up in our week together, Tuesday is a fundraising dinner at the Boulevard Diner. And so anytime from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m., you go in and you eat your meal and let them know that you're there to support New Light Lutheran Church, and part of your check will come back and support our ministry here together. And so that is Tuesday. And we are also just about to start Sunday school. So, Jess Miller, I'm going to make you wave your hands a minute. Can you do a little like, hey, I'm Jess Miller. Just like, yep, that's Jessica. If you would like to register your kid for Sunday school today, you can talk to her and she'll be able to help you find the registration forms. And we'll get into that starting next week. So those are the announcements I wanted to make sure I shared with you. After we worship today, you're going to sit tight and get some directions. We're going to play a couple games where the food gets together, and then we'll feast and continue to celebrate. Thank you for being here as we worship. And I'm going to invite the band to lead us in a prelude as we prepare to meet God in this place. And find the call to worship in the beginning of your bulletin. Today is the 11th anniversary of the beginning of New Light Lutheran Church. And on this 11th anniversary of gather to thank God and to celebrate.
We ask God wisdom for the future.
We gather looking back to see the paths taken.
We look forward to see where God is leading us.
We honor those who have gone before us.
We learn from their choices and their faith.
We celebrate who we are right now today.
And welcome the possibilities and opportunities before us.
We dream of the future that God is calling us into.
The Lord brings us joy and lifts us up in hope.
So come, let us worship and celebrate God who is always with us. God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
We sing to God with our hearts and our spirits. Amen. Another with a sign of peace.
Peace be with you up there.
10. Will you please be seated and open your ears and hearts to the Word of God as it's recorded in the Scriptures.
A reading from Genesis. After burying his father, Joseph went back to Egypt. All of his brothers who had come with him to bury his father returned with him. After the funeral, Joseph's brothers talked among themselves. What if Joseph is carrying a grudge and decides to pay us back for all the wrong we did him? So they sent Joseph a message. Before his death, your father gave this command. Tell Joseph, forgive your brother's sins, all that wrongdoing. They did treat you very badly. Will you do it? Will you forgive the sins of the servants of your father God? When Joseph received their message, he wept. Then the brothers went in person to him, threw themselves on the ground before him, and said, "We'll be your slaves." Joseph replied, "Don't be afraid. Do I act for God? Don't you see? You planned evil against me, but God used those same plans for my good, as you see all around you right now. Life for many people. Easy now. You have nothing to fear. I'll take care of you and your children." He reassured them, speaking with them heart to heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Second reading is from Romans 14. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves. We do not die to ourselves. We live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now, can I ask our youngest children of God and little dance party to come up here with me for a minute?
Yeah!
Oh, watch your step.
Come on up.
Hello. Oh, look, her t-shirt even owns that she's a dancer.
Yep.
All right. Hello. So here's a question for you guys. Do you guys ever make mistakes? Yeah. What about you guys over here? Do you ever make a mistake? Yeah, and things get a little messed up. Sometimes they get a little weird. Hi, come on up. You know, I was thinking about, I got this little string that's kind of a mess up on my, let me just, have you ever, you know, you get a little, and you gotta just, like, pull at it and see if you can just make it work, and whoops, that is not going to work as my example. So never mind about that. There's really a lot of it in there. Let me show you how much string I gotta pull and get that off of the thing. You know, This is kind of like the Bible talks about today. That sometimes you get a mess up and you just work at it and you work at it and you work at it. And sometimes we have people who hurt us and we have to work at it and work at it. And they ask Jesus, how many times, how much do I have to pull at this? How much work do I have to do? And Jesus says you have to forgive people not just 70 times, but 70 times, 7 times. Gotta keep working at it. And so here's the good news. The good news is that as hard as it is for us to forgive a whole bunch of times, as hard as it is for us to keep working at stuff, God never gives up on us. And God is always forgiving us and working with us over and over and over and over and over again. And we give thanks to God for that. Will you bow your heads with me and let's pray. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For loving us.
For loving us.
Enough to forgive us.
Enough to forgive us.
Over and over.
Over and over.
As much as we need it.
As much as we need it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Help us forgive others.
Help us forgive others.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you guys so much. Go ahead and find your spots back.
We know where we're spot on. Come on, help, Toby.
Toby's already up here.
You to open your ears. This is the Holy Gospel, and it's according to St. Matthew in the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
So Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? And Jesus said, not 7 times, but I tell you 77 times or 70 times 7, depending on your translation. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wanted to settle accounts with his slaves. And when he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions and payment to be made. And so the slave fell on his knees before him saying, have patience with me and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. That same slave, when he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. And his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. But he refused. And then he went and threw him in prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. And his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. And so my Heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Will you please bow your heads with me and let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for your word this day, for the places that it challenges us and the places that it reminds us of your grace and mercy. We pray that you would send your spirit in this place. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, just a light little easy to deal with gospel lesson for while we're out here celebrating on the parking lot, right? So this week on Wednesday, I had an MRI. Have you ever had one of these things? Raise your hand. Yeah. Horrible, right? This is no fun. For me, at least, it was pretty close to torture. My husband finds them cozy, but don't listen to him. If you have ever done one of these things, then you know. They lift you up and put you into this tube where you can't move. They tell you don't move, but it doesn't matter because you don't have room to move anyway. And then they start the test and there is banging and clanging and all this noise, and it's like being startled over and over and over again. And my body reacted to the noises like I was in danger, but like I said, you can't move. So this was not a picnic for me, and I'm happy if I never have that experience again. I have big feelings about it. And with today's gospel lesson in my head already, I couldn't help but think that this is a perfect metaphor for how it can feel to be in an unresolved conflict with someone, to be holding a grudge with someone, to know I hurt someone and that they are angry and hurt and mad. Those things feel like what it's like to get an MRI for me. Can you see that? That when our relationships get broken or someone's hurt us or we've hurt someone else, that we get ourselves wrapped up tight and stuck. And there are random things and bangs and startles that will throw you right back into it, even if it's years later. You see someone says something, or a song plays, and all of a sudden you are sad or angry or guilty or frustrated all over again. And it's horrible. And I believe it's not the will of God for us, for our sake, as well as our neighbors who need mercy. But this forgiveness stuff is no picnic. It is not easy. And this is the second week in a row that Jesus has been hammering at us about forgiveness from our gospel readings. And he talks about it a lot. And he mentions it in the prayer that he teaches us as how to pray. We pray, forgive us our sins or debts or trespasses as we forgive those who sin against us. Last week we talked about how Jesus doesn't give us a loophole or an escape hatch to get off the hook of forgiveness. And this week he says even more. This week, Jesus teaches us that forgiveness is a bigger picture than sometimes we talk about, and certainly bigger than we teach kids when they're growing up, right? Because I don't know how you learned about forgiveness, but I learned about it because my brother smacked me and my mom dragged him over and said, say you're sorry. And he said, sorry. Right. And she said, say you forgive him. And I said, I forgive you. And she said, now hug. And everything's done, right? Okay, well, forgiveness, even in that moment, is not as easy as we try to make it fit. And it's certainly not that easy as we grow. But Jesus gives Peter the reminder that we are in it for the long haul and in it for the big picture. 77 times we have to forgive our neighbor. And so what does that mean? Does it mean that I just forgive whether the person deserves it or not? Even if they did the same thing yesterday and they're gonna do it again tomorrow? Does it mean I get to do whatever I want? And because other people love Jesus, I don't have to be accountable to anything? That doesn't sound like our God. That doesn't sound like abundant life. So how do we understand this? We understand it because Jesus tells us a story that helps. Jesus tells this parable, and in it, he teaches us some stuff that goes hand in hand with forgiveness that we sometimes forget about. So first, he tells about this slave who owes 10,000 talents. Well, that's not our money system, so let me translate. This is a gazabillion dollars. Okay, that's the way the audience would have heard it. A ridiculous amount of money. More money than the whole town would have had put together. More money than the king would have had. It is a ludicrous amount of money that he owes. And the idea that he would have to pay it back when he is a slave is ludicrous. Or that he should even pay a debt back to someone who already controls his life and family and food and work and everything. It is supposed to sound absolutely insane. Supposed to sound impossible. That's what's owed. And he begs for mercy, and he's not just given time to go figure it out, but he is forgiven entirely. And that's amazing. And if we ended the story there, that would mean one thing. But then that forgiven servant, he comes upon somebody else who owes him some money left over from lunch. In comparison, it is tiny, but he doesn't have it. And that guy begs him for mercy. The one who has been forgiven says no. And that is supposed to sound jarring to us. It's supposed to sound ridiculous. Who would just turn around and expect from someone else when they've been forgiven so generously? And Jesus tells this story to drive home a couple of points and to set some expectations around this work of forgiveness that, by the way, isn't a suggestion, but that Jesus keeps pointing us to and driving home. And first, the expectation is that repentance is a part of the equation here. This desire to do something better, to do what's right, even if it's impossible to make it right, the sorrow and desire that things could be different and for the debt to be repaid are a part of the package. Neither of the people who need forgiveness are lackadaisical about it. Neither of them are entitled about it. They all come to the person they owe with great grief and great sorrow and aware of their shortcomings and their need for mercy. And their forgiveness is not casual or mindless or without cost. And I think we forget that sometimes. I think we forget it individually and we forget it all sorts of times as a culture. We leave out the part of making something right. We try to gloss over mistakes and say, well, sorry, I forgive you. And now we're not talking about it anymore. Except that's not how the real world works. We repair institutional injustice and say, okay, things are better going forward, so we're going to forget about all the pain of the past. But that doesn't work. Sometimes even after forgiveness is given, there are consequences out of the hurt that was caused, and we work through it together. And that's a part of forgiveness. In a way, this is something that our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters could teach us something. Because when they come to confession, they leave with forgiveness and penance, with something that they do that is meant to work on changing behavior or make things right, or at least make a sacrifice in response to hurt. Because forgiveness is costly. It's not a magic wand. It is a process and a bigger picture than that. And the other assumption Jesus makes in this parable is that Jesus assumes that we will all make, is that when you receive forgiveness, when you receive mercy, that it changes you. That having received something you don't deserve, you don't continue with a hard heart toward everyone else. And that parable pushes us to receive mercy graciously and with your humility, and then to hold ourselves accountable for how we treat each other. Is the slave within his rights to do with what he did? Well, sure. The second guy he met owed him money. And that guy wasn't going to pay it back. Was it according to the law that he could say, you're going to pay me or you're going to go to jail? Well, absolutely. That's according to the law. But it doesn't sound right, and it's not supposed to. When we have been met with a mercy and forgiveness that sets us free, we assume that that changes us to have a softer heart toward others. Jesus assumes that in this parable. And it is uncompromising in holding us to that standard. Okay, so that's the people in the story. So where are we? What about you and me? Where do you find yourself? Where does Jesus call us to find ourselves in this story? Because the thing is, sometimes we kid ourselves about our relationship with what we owe. We say to ourselves, I'm good. I try to be a good person. I'm at least good enough, right? So when it comes to me and God, I mean, sure, I've got sin that I'm accountable for, but it's not so bad. It's not that big a debt that God would have to have me repay. But when we say that to ourselves, we kid ourselves. Because the truth is, when it comes to the debt we owe to be made right with God, we can't pay it off on our own. There is no amount of good deeds or sacrifice that we can make that would equal out the times we sinned against God or our neighbor. And so, in that truth, hear this good news. Forgiveness is brutally hard for us, but it sure comes easily for God. It is God's way of being to meet us in our sin that is too big and to set us free. Forgiveness comes easily for God, but it is still costly. It takes everything. In fact, God loves us so profoundly and completely that God has already gotten to work for our forgiveness that we cannot earn, takes our being whole so seriously that our debts are paid for the cross. And you and me sitting here on a parking lot in Bedrock have received mercy beyond measure. You'll talk to Sheila. Said, "How do you spell that? See me after worship." And you and I, who have been forgiven so completely, still struggle to forgive in our humanness. We sitting here have grudges we hold on tightly. We have heavy hurt we carry and guilt we bear. And sometimes we let our hearts get hard toward others. Receive mercy beyond the telling of it. And sometimes even when someone comes to us for mercy, it's not that we don't know we should forgive, it's just we don't really want to. Even if there's going to be penance or sacrifice or change, sometimes we want to stay mad and make it part of who we are. And that's what Jesus speaks into and challenges us to break apart today. To not let that hardness become a part of our identity. Forgiveness isn't easy. It's costly, and it takes making a choice to let the forgiveness we already received change us. And so I'm going to invite you to do something while we sing our next hymn, because my guess is you probably don't need to look at the words to sing our next hymn. And so instead, I'm going to invite you to take that time to close your eyes and clench up one of your hands and lift up to God and think about any of the hurt you're carrying, any of the guilt you're carrying, any of the anger or grudges or resentment you're carrying, anywhere where your heart feels hard. And as we sing about Amazing Grace, to try to relax your hand a little bit and offer that up. Offer the hurt and anger to God and see if God's mercy can break open your hard heart just a little bit. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand with me. Let's sing.
Amen.
wandering and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We pray for the church. Bless the missions and ministries of diverse congregations, that they would uplift the good news of salvation in ways that can be understood. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for all who govern. Encourage those in positions of power to lead with empathy, practice forgiveness, and care for those who struggle. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for our neighbors who face illness of any kind, for those strained financially, for anyone living with chronic pain, mental illness, the disease of addiction, or otherwise afraid or in harm's way. Protect all who cry out for mercy, especially those we name before you now, out loud or in the silence of our hearts.
For Lauren and for Maddie and for the doctors and nurses, that things go smoothly tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy.
Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for this congregation. Open our hearts to practice intentional invitation. Help us to forgive each other, to practice patience, and to choose welcome over judgment. Move us to care for those in our community who are seeking refuge and safety. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We give thanks for the saints who died in faith. Show us how to live faithfully, creatively, and lovingly in your church and in your world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these in the prayers of our hearts, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As we come up to communion today, you are welcome to give an offering or tithes today. There's a big basket right here as you're making your way to communion, or there is a link there in your bulletin that you can use. Let's say a prayer of blessing for the gifts that will be given today. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. O God before time, God at the end, we delight in the splendor of your universe. Daily we laud your continuing creation, and we give thanks. We glorify you now and forever.
We glorify you now and forever.
God of the covenant, God of the church, we hear you speaking to centuries of your people. And we come today as your children to this table and give you thanks for your presence here in this place and around the world. We praise you now and forever.
We praise you now and forever.
You gave us Mary and Magdalene, Peter and Paul. You gave us the saints of all of this place and all places, and we bless you now and forever.
We bless you now and forever.
You came as Jesus, our wisdom, our guide, embodying forgiveness, granting us grace, setting us free, dying for sin, and alive for the life of the world. We worship you now and forever.
We worship you now and forever.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his death, we cry out, "Amen." Celebrating his resurrection, we shout amen.
Amen.
Trusting his presence in every time and every place, we plead amen.
Amen.
Come, Holy Spirit, and make here the body of Christ. Breathe onto this food that it brings us your life. By your Spirit, preserve what is faithful, reform what we treasure, create in us what is vital and new. We honor you now and forever.
We honor you now and forever.
God before time, God at the end, Father, Son, and Spirit, we laud you. Glory and praise, blessing and worship, honor and power and might be to you, our God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. You are welcome at this table, and as you are invited forward, you'll receive the bread. Having received that, you can choose either the red wine or white grape juice and so receive the gifts of God. If you are not able to come forward safely today, then after everyone has been served, then I will bring communion to you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, and all are welcome at the Lord's table.
Thank you. There we
My flower decorating skills are not the best part.
There's still time to learn.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for you have fed us with this heavenly food. In your grace and by your Spirit, help us to be what we celebrate, the body of Christ in the world. Send us out renewed by this meal to do the work you have given us to do, to witness for Christ and to love you with singleness of heart, and to serve you with clarity of purpose through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Will you please stand as you are able and receive God's blessing. Go forth in peace and with courage of faith. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself.
Amen. Amen.
Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him.
Amen.
And the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
weather consultation. It sounds like it is starting to sprinkle just a little bit. So we're going to, never fear, but here comes a plan. But first, let's pray. So let's please bow your heads with me and let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for our brothers and sisters. We thank you for old and new friends. We pray for your blessing on the food we will enjoy and on our time together today. And we pray these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Go ahead and please be seated and let me give you like 5 seconds of direction before our dismissal today. So, this was going to transition us right into some games, but since it's starting to drizzle, we were thinking what we're going to do instead is go ahead and go into lunch and have lunch, and you will hear direction of either some indoor games or it's safe to go outside, so come and play. So I want to give you the quick note about games. When we play games, we will split into teams, and then from the teams take volunteers to do stuff. So your role on the team can be cheerleader. Yay, go team, right? And I say that in case, like me, you would hear we're about to do team games and hide in the bathroom. You don't have to hide in the bathroom, okay? There's all sorts of ways that we're gonna do this together. But first, I think what we're gonna do is go inside. There are places to sit in the hospitality room, in the next room over, and in the room at the end of the hall. Go ahead and get your drinks, and then we'll line up on the tables and go ahead and enjoy the lunch that has been prepared. Thank you for everyone who has brought dishes to share. Thank you to everyone who has worshiped today. And now go in peace and love your neighbor. Thanks be to God. God bless you all.
Oh my God.
Praise God.
Rock and New Light Church.
Yeah.